Hi everyone, I'm Prateek, a dentist and specialty doctor, and in this video we're going to be looking at a very common post-extraction complication, dry sockets. If you want to see more educational videos similar to this, then please make sure you subscribe to the channel. So a dry socket, or alveolar osteitis, occurs when a blood clot fails to form in a socket post-extraction, or is dislodged or lost from the socket before healing has occurred. The blood clot forms two purposes following an extraction. Firstly, it forms the basis for new bone and new soft tissue to form in the area, so that things can return to normal. And secondly, it helps protect the underlying bone and nerves, and therefore if it is lost, these are exposed and the patient usually experiences pain. So if the clot is lost, patients will have impaired healing and they'll also experience symptoms, i.e. pain. If we look at the etiology, or the causes of a dry socket, this is an area that is up for intense debate. However, there are some obvious risk factors that increase your risk of developing a dry socket. The first one of these is smoking and tobacco use. For example, we know nicotine causes vasoconstriction, and with vasoconstriction, you will have a reduced blood supply to the area in order to help healing. This is why we advise patients not to smoke for as long as possible following an extraction. Similar to this, patients who have had radiotherapy have hypovascular bones, so they have reduced blood supply to these areas. Therefore, along with their risk of developing osteoradionecrosis following an extraction, they also have a potentially higher risk of developing a dry socket. If we look at the extraction itself, the area the tooth is being taken out from also has an impact. So anatomically, the maxilla has a lower incidence compared to the mandible, and the more posterior the tooth, the higher the risk of a dry socket compared to an anterior tooth. The reason behind this, again, comes down to vascularity. So the maxilla is more vascular compared to the mandible, and the more posterior the tooth, the lower the vascularity compared to an anterior tooth. Additionally, posterior teeth tend to have larger sockets, and therefore the demand in terms of healing is greater. There's a bigger socket to fill, more blood is needed, and therefore the capacity for a dry socket increases. So mandible has a higher risk than the maxilla, and posterior teeth have a higher risk than anterior teeth. Additionally, if the extraction is particularly traumatic, then the patient is usually at a higher risk of a dry socket. So this is why dry sockets are extremely common following extraction of lower third molars, because they're in the mandible, they're posterior teeth, and they typically are difficult extractions, so there's a lot going against them. Additionally, if patients fail to follow the post-operative advice, their risk may be higher. So we advise patients to not rinse and not spit out following an extraction. And the reason behind this is to avoid that blood clot either failing to form or dislodging completely once it has formed. However, if patients fail to follow this advice, that blood clot is going to struggle to stay in place and their risk of a dry socket will increase. Other factors that may increase the risk of a dry socket include if the patient's got a pre-existing infection, and also hormonal changes. So patients who are on the oral contraceptive pill, for example, we tend to see a higher rate of dry sockets, and this may be due to the fact that hormone changes can impair your ability to heal. Next, let's look at the signs and symptoms of a dry socket. It's important to note that a true dry socket is not an infection. So a patient will typically not have a fever or pyrexia, they will not usually have enlarged lymph nodes or lymphadenopathy, and typically there won't be any pus in the socket. However, patients who are typically at a higher risk of a dry socket are also at a higher risk of infection, and therefore we often see them occurring together. If we look at the true symptoms of a dry socket, the most important one is that patients will experience pain. Now this is typically moderate to severe, dull throbbing pain from the area of extraction. It usually develops a few days after the extraction, and a lot of patients will describe it as being worse than the pain they experienced before in terms of toothache. Typically, you can't control it through regular analgesia. Additionally, patients may be experiencing bad breath or halitosis, and they may have a bad taste in their mouth, usually a metallic taste. If we then clinically looked at the socket, in terms of the signs that we'd see, there would either be a loss of the clot completely or a partial loss of the clot in the socket. There may also be some debris in the socket. And usually there is localized inflammation of the soft tissues surrounding the socket. In order to diagnose a dry socket, we don't necessarily need any imaging of sorts. This is usually a diagnosis that is done through clinical factors and also looking at the patient's history. It becomes very, very obvious when the patient mentions the symptoms that we've discussed and we see the signs that we've discussed. A dry socket is usually the obvious diagnosis. Now, in terms of management, managing a dry socket is usually symptomatically done. So we first gently irrigate the socket with saline or with a local anesthetic, and this helps get rid of any debris that's in the socket that may be impairing healing. This may also encourage some bleeding from the socket and the fresh blood may form a new clot. We then usually put a sedative dressing into the socket, such as Alvechol. This helps relieve the patient's pain, but it also again can form the basis for a new clot to form. Next, we want to ensure that the patient follows the correct postoperative advice, so we need to remind them not to rinse, not to spit out, no exertions, so that when the new clot is forming, it can stay there and it won't get dislodged again. Additionally, patients may need some advice regarding analgesia, so either we need to work through the WHO pain ladder and just recommend what they should use, or we need to prescribe them something to help manage their pain if necessary. And finally, if the patient does have an infection along with the dry socket, then we may have to prescribe antibiotics if they've got systemic signs. So there we go, we've looked at what a dry socket is, the risk factors for developing a dry socket, the signs and symptoms and how we diagnose a dry socket, as well as the management of a dry socket. But these are really important things to know because it's such a common post-extraction complication. It's something that can easily be handled in practice. My recommendation in this video is another YouTuber called Dentist Raj. Now, Raj is currently studying dentistry and his YouTube channel is excellent for anyone who's currently on a dental course, as he discusses a lot of the issues relating to going through a dental course, as well as giving you some helpful tips. So I'll put the link in the description, make sure to check the channel out. If you find this video useful, please make sure to like, comment and subscribe, and let me know if any other videos that you'd like me to do. Until the next video, take care.